Is SpaceX getting ready to catch a Starship? Mechazilla receives more upgrades? What is this? New details regarding the Starship propellant transfer demo? The construction of the second tower continues, Astroscale reveals first pictures of space debris, and the Ariane 6 inaugural flight is getting closer. What's up everyone, TJ here from What About It. Now, enough about me, let's get into it. Starship updates. SpaceX had another intense week. The first orbital launch site is changing. Want to know more? Follow me. Back at Starbase, the torch party is about to be resumed. After the workers cut and scrapped the GSC tank used for water storage, it's now time to tackle the nitrogen tank. In the past few days, our photographer John has spotted several vacuum trucks at the tank farm. They're probably there just to suck out the perlite insulation sandwiched between the tank's outer shell and the main body. Once the perlite is fully removed, the torches will be fired up again to slice the tank into smaller sections. You can even already see the red markings on the tank, outlining where the cuts will be made. With the removal of this next tank, the original vertical tank farm, which started with 8 tanks, will be reduced to just 4. That's actually a good sign. It's pretty clear that the next wet dress rehearsal will already use up some of the new horizontal bullet tanks. I'd be even more excited to see red markings on the liquid oxygen tanks. That would indicate a shift towards using horizontal tanks only. This will be a huge step towards making the tank farm more reliable. Shockwaves generated during liftoff will no longer be a concern. Also, the views will just get better because there's not going to be like tanks in front of the rocket anymore, which is awesome. Meanwhile, work also continues at the Orbital Launch Integration Tower, or OLIT, O-L-I-T. At first sight, it definitely doesn't look like SpaceX will be able to launch anything from this place in under a month. But you gotta just trust the process. The engineering magicians at Starbase have shown time and time again that getting rid of all that scaffolding is just a thing that you can do in a matter of hours. The ongoing upgrades to both the tower and the launch table are most likely aimed at increasing redundancy and reducing the time needed for refurbishment between launches. It also appears that some of them are specifically designed to prepare the site for booster recovery. On April 25th, we saw a return of something only true Starship veterans remember. Originally, the Mechazilla was outfitted with square padding pieces intended to protect the prototypes during lifting or catching maneuvers. Oddly enough, this padding once caused damage to the tiles on a prototype during lifting, leading to their quick removal. Since that incident, Mechazilla has undergone many upgrades, including modifications to the stabilization pins, which might now provide enough clearance to prevent this issue. If you take a closer look at the chopstick arms, you'll notice that once again they have mounting points for additional padding. It seems likely that we'll soon see them fully padded. The options for a super heavy catch soon is getting real. It's gonna be nuts. This thing is huge, it's falling from the sky very fast, and it's gonna be caught by a robot. What? Okay. Anyways, the next day we saw some really impressive tests of the chopsticks. Believe it or not, what you're seeing right now wasn't sped up. The acceleration during this test was insane, to say the least. However, with great speed comes great oscillation? Yes. Moving huge objects with such speed also means that stopping it is equally as hard, which is why we see this wobble at the end. Definitely not something you want to see during a catch attempt. This might explain why SpaceX is already testing the chopsticks in these scenarios. Maybe they want to develop an acceleration profile that minimizes oscillation as much as possible. Just to remind you, according to Elon Musk, we may see the first recovery attempt as early as the 5th flight of Starship. As you know, in the mission before that, Flight 4, the Super Heavy booster will attempt to land on a virtual tower in the Gulf of Mexico. What are your thoughts? Could simulating the landing ahead of time really help the actual event? Should they just consider building a catch-only tower? Please share your thoughts in the comments. Speaking of Flight 4, let's move to the production site, where preparations are underway for the next Starship flight. Starting with the booster, its state still remains somewhat a mystery. However, one thing is certain, it will soon receive its hot staging ring, which has been moved to the front of the first mega bay. Once installed, we should be on the brink of another rollout, which should happen any day now. Similarly, Ship 29 is nearing its move back to the launch site, and the saga of its heat shield tiles is finally wrapping up, with nearly all the tiles on its forward flaps reattached. There are also new pink stickers on the nose cone tiles, which is hard to interpret their meaning. Moving downward, the large stripe of tiles has also been reattached, and this time it's clear that they used red adhesive, which replaced the previously used blue glue found in this area. While there's still some finishing touches needed in the aft section, it looks like we're nearing completion. In fact, even NASA is pretty optimistic about SpaceX's progress. Amit Chatria mentioned during NASA's advisory council meeting on the Moon to Mars strategy that they expect SpaceX could be ready for another launch by the end of May. At this meeting, they also revealed a few more insights related to the Starship side of the Human Landing System program. First and foremost, the propellant transfer demo was a success. During the third flight, a few minutes after liftoff, liquid oxygen began flowing from the header tank to the main oxidizer tank. Although the data is still under review, the initial results indicate the test was a complete success, a significant milestone towards enabling propellant transfers between prototypes. Now, while we won't see ship-to-ship transfer happening until at least 2025, we did get a few details regarding this future mission. They go on to explain that both starships involved in the propellant demo will launch from Starbase, which implies that no such mission can occur until both launch towers are fully functional. The propellant transfer demonstration will go something like this. First, we'll see the launch of the Target prototype, which despite its name, will play the active role during docking. Then a second ship, known as the Chaser, will launch later and position itself ahead of the target in passive docking mode. In simpler terms, this means that the Chaser will remain stationary, while the target performs the maneuvers necessary to dock with the Chaser. This might seem a little counterintuitive, but given Starship's capabilities, the prototype will likely be able to switch between acting as the active or passive vehicle. Once docked side by side, the Chaser ship will connect its quick disconnect to the target ship to start transferring propellant. According to NASA, this QD panel will be identical to the one used for fueling ships at the launch pad. Although keep in mind that this will be way into the development of Starship V2, so the QD that we see today may look entirely different than what we see flying on this flight. By the end of this year, SpaceX aims to have most of the technology ready for this test ready, including the docking mechanisms, LiDAR sensors for navigations, QDs, and hot gas thrusters. Wait, did I just say hot gas thrusters? Yes. You might recall one of our previous episodes where we discussed various maneuvering techniques used in space. Back then, we had revealed that SpaceX already had a hot gas thruster prototype, and they decided to shelve the idea. But we wouldn't be surprised if it made a comeback. So there you have it. We may see the resurrection of the hot gas thrusters in the end. All these tests should accumulate in the HLS moon landing demonstration. As part of the Artemis program, SpaceX is not only tasked with providing a lander for Artemis 3, but also must successfully land at least an uncrewed ship on the moon to validate their technology. The initial contract didn't include the requirement for the lander to ascend back to orbit after landing, which sparked some controversy. After all, if you're already there, why not attempt to launch from the lunar surface? Anyways, it seems SpaceX and NASA have reached a similar conclusion, as the demonstration HLS mission now will also include a moon liftoff. Good. It's great to see progress towards our return to the moon. Man, this landing is gonna be so sick. And before I tell you about one of the most crucial elements required for these tests, the second tower, here's a word from our sponsor, Ground News.
Did you know three companies are in the running for NASA's next moon rover? Through Ground News, I found 56 articles about this topic.
Whoa!
What?
Wow!
Ground News combines all the world's news in one place so we can compare coverage. I've been working with Ground News for over a year now, and I think what they are doing is really important, especially today where space news doesn't often dominate the headlines. Click the link or scan the code to discover news you have missed. Looking at this story, nearly all the articles are coming from the left and center. So people who get their news from the right might not know about this. Comparing the headlines, we can see some interesting distinctions, revealing left-labeled articles emphasized advancements, while right-labeled articles highlighted importance, as in NASA astronauts to drive moon buggy for first time in half a century. Through this, Ground News illustrated how this topic is presented in varied ways to different audiences. And you can do this on any topic. I've been following news on SpaceX, aviation, NASA to get the latest news and make sure I'm getting diverse perspectives. Go to ground.news/y for 40% off the Advantage subscription, the same plan I use to research these topics, and by signing up, you will be supporting our channel.
All right, back to Starbase. Thanks to a bird's eye view, courtesy of Redline Helicopter Tours, our speculations have been confirmed. SpaceX's team has begun working on the previously restricted wetlands area. While we haven't seen an official approval, just a request, it's very likely that they've already received the green light from the government. Recent ground level photos reveal the return of the Wick Drain Stitcher to the suborbital test site, which is adding drains to the aforementioned wetland section. This shot gives a great perspective on just how large the mountain of soil has become. They really need a lot of downward pressure to squeeze out most of that water. We also spotted a truck carrying a few continuous flight augers parked next to Starhopper. You know what this could mean, right? The piles are back. We may soon see another major step in construction at the second launch site. These augers dig deep into the ground to allow for the insertion of rebar cages, which are then filled with concrete. This process not only will stabilize the soil, but combined with a pile cap, will form a strong foundation for the upcoming second tank farm and launch tower. Fortunately, it looks like all this groundwork won't disrupt Starship's testing schedule. Cameron County has released two new road closures, one for April 29th and another for April 30th, the day this video is released. While we can't predict the future, the most likely reason for these closures is the rollout in either a spin prime or static fire test of Ship 30. Having recently had its engines installed in the second megabay, Ship 30 is the ideal candidate for testing. It's really cool seeing how much you can discover by looking at things from the air. Did you know that you can take a helicopter ride over Starbase and get the same views as our videos? Visit redlineheli.com/Felix to book your helicopter ride over Starbase with $25 off. You need to give this a try. I know you'll love it. We've also looked into our channel metrics. Over 2 million returning monthly viewers have not subscribed yet. Help us grow the channel even further by double checking that you've hit that subscribe button so you don't miss our updates. And while you're at it, give us a like and become a Wise supporter for exclusive space updates. With it, you get access to daily Starbase photo galleries, including satellite, aerial, and ground photos of SpaceX's launch progress, and countless other extras on top. And no matter how much you decide to give, everyone gets the same supporter content and access. You decide what you want to give. And just as a reminder, on April 19th, we launched one of our most ambitious projects yet, Y Live. We have cameras at Starbase and Port Canaveral. You may have seen snippets from these cameras before, but now you can watch them 24/7. And not just that. We live stream heli flights and show pictures, launches, tests, and interviews. It's packed. Thank you so much for watching. Now, we've got something special for you. Check out these latest photos from Massey's. Notice anything different? Yes, the perspective has changed. This is all thanks to Keith from Raptor Roost, who got us on a boat, which allowed us to photograph and capture some truly stunning views of SpaceX's remote test site at Massey's. They managed to get some detailed shots like the quick disconnect panel from the back and the methane tank farm up close. What might also grab your attention in these images is the massive steel can. That's Booster 13. On the night of April 25th, this prototype finally rolled out from the first mega bay after months of work. As it made its way down Highway 4 to Massey's, we noticed something interesting. This Super Heavy was fitted with a top cap, a white disc mounted on top of the forward dome. But why? This is likely just a protective measure against the elements. While rain won't really damage the booster, cleaning it up afterwards is a hassle, and it could delay flight preparation. So this is all likely just coming down to efficiency. Looking closer at the prototype, we can spot several differences from previous versions. Most notably, the vents have been completely revamped. The methane tank no longer sports visible vents. Instead, the liquid oxygen tank now features 3 vents on one side and 4 on the other. Interestingly, these vents lack the cowbell-shaped nozzles seen on previous prototypes. This modification might be related to the change of the separation method. With hot staging, the booster can just flip using mainly the engines. Beneath 2 of these vents, SpaceX added new cameras. Hopefully, during the flight of this prototype, we'll be treated with some incredible onboard footage. Another significant change is the new design of the raceway, which protects the avionics systems of the Super Heavy. The raceway now connects to the quick disconnect box at an angle that has been significantly simplified, with many box-shaped components removed. After arriving at Massey's, the prototype underwent a cryogenic test of the methane tank. This test revealed that at least 2 of the vents mentioned earlier are connected to the methane tank, not the LOX one. With that test out of the way, the next step is to cryo test the liquid oxygen tank. Then Booster 13 will make its way back to the Mega Bay for engine installation. When do you think we'll see the static fire of this prototype? Can they make it before Flight 5? Please let me know in the comments. I'd love to hear your thoughts. Now, if you've been following What About It for a while, you might recall the launch of the Electron rocket we covered back in February. It marked only the second flight of Rocket Lab this year, and it carried something truly fascinating under the rocket's fairing, a satellite called ADRAS-J. ADRAS-J is part of a larger initiative called the Active Debris Removal by Astroscale. This company is leading the fight against space debris. However, to better understand their goal, let's rewind to January 2009, when the Japanese Space Agency launched the H-2A rocket. This rocket carried the Greenhouse Gases Observing Satellite, also known as GOSAT. After releasing the payload, the second stage of H-2A was not deorbited, leaving it in an orbit with an apogee of over 600 kilometers or 370 miles. At such altitudes, satellites can stay in space for 25 years or more before atmospheric decay finally forces it to re-enter the atmosphere. Currently, objects like this are not a major concern. It's quite rare for space debris to cause significant issues such as delaying flights, and most satellites can maneuver to avoid potential collisions. However, if we don't address this issue now, it could become much more problematic in the future. This caused JAXA and Astroscale to start a debris removal program. The ADRAS-J mission was to locate and rendezvous with the debris. It was the first time a satellite designed for debris removal was able to rendezvous with its target. So cool. As it approached the abandoned second stage, the spacecraft managed to capture this incredible image. One interesting thing to note here is that during liftoff, the rocket itself was mostly light orange. However, after years of being exposed to UV light, it turned the spray-on insulation into this deep brown color. The same thing happens with the Space Launch System. During its construction, the insulation is mostly yellow, but as it absorbs UV light, it transitions into this rusty brown. Having captured the first images, the satellite will now orbit around the debris, collecting more data, which should help create a 3D model of the object. Recently, JAXA selected Astroscale for the second phase of the program, where the company will be tasked with constructing and launching a similar satellite, this time equipped with a robotic arm. This arm will allow the satellites to grab the second stage, after which it will engage its engine to deorbit it. This is a massive leap toward managing trash we leave in orbit. It's a very solvable problem if we put our minds to it. I'm excited to see more missions like this. Pictures of space hardware in actual space is always really cool. Which also feels surreal is the fact that Ariane 6 may actually launch this year. The newest rocket from Ariane Space was supposed to be operational before the Ariane 5 retired, a smooth transition that wouldn't hurt the launch cadence. In reality though, it hasn't been all roses and sunshine. In fact, Ariane Space hasn't launched any heavy lift rocket in almost a year now. The last time we've checked on Ariane was back in December 2023, when its second stage failed to complete its static fire test in Germany. Since then, in February, the rocket's central core was shipped aboard the Canopy, a cargo ship with sails constructed in Poland and finished in the Netherlands. In less than 2 weeks, it made its way from Bremen, Germany to Kourou, French Guiana, where Europe's spaceport is located. It's interesting that Europe's biggest launch site isn't actually in Europe, but that's like a topic for another episode. By March, the center stage and the upper stage of the rocket were integrated. Around the same time, the Ariane 6 test model was dismantled, making room for the actual rocket. Then, at the end of April, the core stage was verticalized in the vehicle assembly building and its two P120 solid rocket boosters were attached. This creates the Ariane 62 configuration. Now, all that's left is to conduct a qualification on review, which should be happening soon. Once that's completed, the Ariane 6 will be ready to receive its payload, anticipated to arrive in May. If all goes as planned, Ariane 6 will take to the skies sometime between June 15th and July 21st, 2025. 2024. All jokes aside, it's great to finally see some progress regarding Europe's largest launcher. This launch will be spectacular. And that's it for today. Remember to gently tap that like button, it can be a bit finicky, and subscribe for more awesome space content. These engagements fuel the algorithm and help us out immensely. And oh, while you're here, check out our epic shirts on our Space Nerd store. The link is in the description. And if you want to increase your space IQ even further, watch this next video and continue your journey. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you all in the next video. Bye. Boy, what am I, how am I screwing that up? Sorry. Like, isn't this a nice look? Look at me, look at, I'm just looking at the camera like, wow. Hi. inverted hand on hip, TJ. Maybe not.